to be back from Nashville, Mr. Prevost.
Oh, yeah. The Music City. The sleeps for no one.
It sleeps. I don't know. A lot of places did shut down kind of early there, I thought, to be honest. Because they were making it seem like that rooftop bar we wanted to go and visit. They said it's too
cold. We
did
go to the Tin Roof Bar.
Yeah.
That was nice. B.B. King's Blues Bar.
Well, if you didn't catch it, we have a ton of coverage of the event across shows like this one, What the Truck. You put out an article that compiled most of those videos. All three sections are out on podcast players everywhere. There's some FreightWaves live and events podcast out. The one with you, it's Susie Schoenberg from flexport.org.
Yep.
How they're going to save the earth.
All kinds of good content.
Mark Weiss from NASA on FreightWaves Insiders is out right now. And you know what? You know who's following me to Tennessee? Tom Brady.
Following you?
Well, he's coming to Tennessee.
Well, you know, that is really going to, I mean, it's like I'm kind of excited, and yet, don't I hate Tom Brady and the Patriots?
You're an NFC South fan. How could you care that much?
Winning cures everything.
The Titans don't often get to the Patriots to begin with, and the one time you did, you beat them, so.
So take that!
Yeah, the final boss. So what do you think? Like, Tom Brady, if you can't beat him, join him? He's going to jump on board?
Yeah, maybe.
All right, what about
That would help. Tannehill, I love you, man.
All right, I guess it sounds like...
Divided loyalties. No, he could maybe stay on as the backup. Right?
All right.
Okay.
Big show today. We're going to talk about if ELDs are causing accidents with Casandra Gaines. She's got a big argument about that. We'll do some freight forecasting. Transportation earnings. We'll talk about the coronavirus and its impact on your supply chain. Plus...
Is it infecting everything? And yes, plus, right now, it is time... For bill paying time.
Yes, this episode is brought to you by DHL Supply Chain, the world's leading logistics company. DHL Supply Chain's team of experts simplifying the complex and work with you to find solutions to your biggest transportation challenges. Learn how DHL can help your business at
logistics.dhl.com.
All right. All right, North America's largest third-party logistics provider held the line on trucking volumes but paid for it in profitability. A week ago, we talked to their CEO.
Yep.
C.H. Robinson reported its operating and financial results for the fourth quarter of 2019. After a close on Tuesday, Robinson reported total revenues of $3.79 billion in the fourth quarter, which was down 8.3% year-over-year. Net income of $99.1 million, down 47% year-over-year. That's tough. Earnings per share fell 45.5% to 73 cents, well below the street's consensus expectations of 96 cents. So a tough week for C.H. Robinson. Good thing they have that lab. That's a positive, though.
Right. And, you know, CEO Bob Biesterfield, he cited a quarter of challenging operating results. They're getting out there, getting ahead of it, but noted that Robinson's brokers were able to adjust pricing and halt the truckload volume slide the company experienced in the third quarter. LTL volumes even grew 4.5% year over year, although volumes for the overall LTL sector were negative. Biesterfield called out how Robinson's substantial investments in technology are beginning to drive operating efficiencies in the business, opening up a 330 BPS favorable spread between truckload volume growth and headcount growth. If North American surface transportation freight brokers can cover more loads per person per day, the company creates operating leverage such that a trucking recovery will generate asymmetric upside for Robinson.
And that's why they had to create that lab, right? The technology lab. Because if you look at trucking as a business and each trucking transaction is $1,000, it's very hard to find marginality in all of that. And the best way to increase revenue is to create efficiency. And that's through technology and process, all the things that technology is good at, through automation and process technology and pricing. And all of those things. So if you can't make extra bucks, you can make those dollars quicker and with less people.
Right, and I think we know the technology is not a cure-all, but when you source that in-house, you bring in great talent, well, it's going to do the very thing you just said, and what it's good at, automating and creating efficiency.
In the fourth quarter of 2019, C.H. Robinson management was faced with a choice: let volumes continue to deteriorate and see market share fall, or reprice contractual business aggressively to maintain share at the expense of profitability. Robinson chose the latter. C.H. Robinson also announced plans, so another bright side, though. They're still expanding, right?
Yeah,
so this doesn't have them that concerned, and maybe it shouldn't have you. C.H. Robinson also announced plans this week to acquire Prime Distribution Services from Roadrunner, who's divesting a lot of assets, for $225 million. This will add, 2.6 million square feet to C.H. Robinson's warehouse network, and it's going to add some lane density.
So that's a pretty good expansion there. Also, yeah. Volkswagen's TRATON SE truck unit late Thursday offered $2.9 billion, or $35 a share in cash for the 83% of Navistar International Corporation it does not already own. The news, first reported by Bloomberg, broke after U.S. markets closed. After-hours trading in Navistar, which makes international-branded medium- and heavy-duty trucks, sent the stock rocketing 47% higher to $35.60 above Trayton's offer price.
All right, now for some scary news. I mean, if you turn the TV on, it's hard to avoid the coronavirus. Right. The good news is the World Health Organization on Thursday declared the spreading of the virus is a public health emergency and there's reason for international concern, but it was not recommending any restrictions on international travel or trade. During a press briefing in Geneva, Dr. Tedros, I'm going to leave it at that, whose director general said there is no reason for measures that unnecessarily interfere with international travel or trade. He called on all countries to make decisions regarding restrictions that are evidence-based.
Yeah, you know,
don't panic.
There is a virus in the United States that's infected 15 million people that we're not talking about.
The flu?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Kills 80,000 a year.
So, I mean, that's...
Yeah.
It's not so novel, but it is happening. The main reason...
You might die driving home. Like, you have a better chance, a much better chance of that. There's a very good chance, not a very good chance, okay. But a much better chance you'll die.
You sound like Casandra Gaines.
Okay, I'm right? Just saying. Don't drive home.
Right.
Just stay at work for the rest of your life.
According to who you just mentioned, Tedros.
Yes.
He said, the main reason for this declaration is not because of what is happening in China, but because of what is happening in other countries. He added that the WHO Emergencies Committee's greatest concern is the potential for the virus to spread to countries with weaker health systems that are not prepared to deal with it. He praised China's handling of the outbreak and said the organization opposes any travel restrictions leveled against China.
Yeah, but it's still affecting airlines. United is among the carriers that have reduced service because of falling demand. The airline said Thursday it is reducing from 12 to 4 of its daily departures from the U.S. to China effective February 9th. And that's going to go all the way through March 28th. United had announced more limited reductions earlier in the week. United's reductions involve Beijing, Hong Kong, and Shanghai. It said there are no planned reductions at this time for Chengdu. Numerous other airlines have announced service reductions or suspensions in the past few days. There are 7,818 cases of the coronavirus around the world that may have gone up. That's a very specific number. 170 people have died. It's gone through 18 countries. But beyond just that, beyond the airlines we meant, so there's the disruptions to the airlines. The most immediate effects that people are seeing in supply chain are due to Chinese New Year. It's the largest migratory event on Earth. Without
seasonality.
Even in perfect weather with the greatest holiday there can be, that's still about 21 days of disruption because people leave work for a week, but a lot of people in China have to migrate very far distances. Their villages are not right next to their office. They don't live in the same town where they work, and a lot of them live in the on site on the actual factory. Some of them will work for a few years straight, then go back home and not come back at all.
Wow.
They'll go to other jobs. But where the disruption is happening is now this is extending beyond the 3 weeks. Because factories are staying closed a little bit longer to make sure they're safe so you don't bring a bunch of people into the compound that get everybody sick.
Yeah, they're taking the precautions that they can. And we also have some analysis, like economist Paul Bingham, director of transportation consulting at IHS Market. He told FreightWaves, what's happening is that the gap you managed against is now extended. If these factories don't restart, or if they restart and then they run out of parts due to issues with first-tier suppliers, how quickly that trickles down will depend on how tightly supply chains are being managed in terms of lead times and buffer stocks. But I think that it will be less than a month before you'd start to see evidence of disruptions, he said.
It's interesting timing, too, because IMO 2020, that regulation came in on the 6th. Bunker marine fuel pricing is tied to crude oil pricing. The coronavirus crisis has caused a sharp drop in crude, though, so container line should at least get a little bit of pricing advantage there. Some of the production that we're going to lose during this thing, and some of its consumption production, things like that, where people are sheltering in place, that can't be recovered in an economy. So not in the U.S. economy, most people listening here, not impacted, but there are impacts going on in China.
Yeah, and in terms of trade, Bingham also had this to say, if China's economy is weaker than they were expecting, they won't have the demand they expected, and some of that demand they were planning to fulfill with U.S. exports. If demand declines and they've got that wiggle room in the language of the agreement, they can say, sorry, we just can't meet the level of commitment. We don't have the consumption level to justify it. So if we're going to see major disruptions on some of this, it looks like it may be delayed, and it looks like they have some wiggle room.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know that we have Casandra Gaines. Yeah. We're supposed to be dialing out to her at 1. We're already a minute behind. There is a Send TMS has added parking to their app. It's a huge problem. I don't know if we have to save that one for Monday or we'll get to it at the end of the show.
If we don't have time to, let's touch on it at the on our next show because
it's a big issue.
Yeah.
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 And in a lot of ways, it's going to be a show in and of itself.
Because, you'll hear, real briefly, you'll hear these little announcements of like, hey, you know, pilots opening up a 40 new show. Boy, that'll increase parking. That's a drop in the bucket. This story, though, may actually be a little bit of a difference maker.
Yes. So,
yeah.
I'm trying to figure out if our guys are dialing out to Casandra as we wait here. I'm not sure what exactly they're doing. So maybe we will get in this topic, and then once they pull her up, then we'll go to it. Start us out on the story.
Well, sure. It's the American, you know, we know the American Transportation Research Institute.
Oh, look at that.
Oh.
There we go.
Wow, hello.
Oh, we were just like.
I love her background.
Man, hold on a second. We got to play your entrance music. You just popped in on us out of nowhere.
F you. I hate everybody. I'm the man. I will never give you
one.
Wow.
Order in the court.
Oh, get it.
How did we take this long to add video? You're just stunning. Look at this. Where are you?
Looking
in an alley?
Great.
Did you?
Thank you.
What are you, behind a punk rock bar or something right now?
Yeah, so I tried to do a gray background or a pink background and nothing was working. And then I found this and I'm like, this is me.
Yeah, very punk rock.
Yeah, no, I dig it. I dig it. So, Casandra, you've been on multiple times. We don't really necessarily need to introduce you to this audience, but you sent me something and you said you're ready for an argument and you wanted to argue that accidents being up 5.7% were due to ELDs. Tell me your slant here.
Okay. So I've heard a lot about this and I'm going to call bull crap.
Okay.
Mostly because, it's not the ELDs that are causing the accidents. You ready for this? It's that everybody suddenly has to be compliant with the law.
Ah, yeah. Yeah, okay, yeah.
So they're, come on, guys. Every trucking company out there that has more than.
Yeah.
Is she breaking up?
I don't know, we just lost her sound. And audience, bear with us, it's our first time. This is our first time doing this one, but I'll put some context. She's going extra crazy.
She's going crazy right now.
She's actually literally being censored during everything that she says. So,
can you hear us, Casandra?
I will put some context. Yes. During a similar study conducted by the FMCSA in 2001 to 2003, the FMCSA said that a primary finding of the study, listen to this, they studied this for 2 years, right? They said that the vast majority of crashes were the critical reason for the crash was assigned to large truck. It was attributed to driver-related action, or get this, Chad, inaction. So it could have been anything.
Wow, that is so provocative and insightful. I mean, no wonder they studied it for.
Oh, I think I hear
her.
We can
hear
her
typing. Oh, there she is. No,
you can hear me.
Yeah.
Oh, you're back. Nice,
Casandra. You know, actually, I know what you're saying about like the it's not ELDs, it's compliance with the law. That's one thing. You know, also, and there may be a lot of stuff going on here. You can talk about the inflexibility of HOS possibly, but I in my brief research, I was noticing that it seems like almost every year there's claims of like how there's more trucking accidents than ever. Is this just more of that same, or is there some substance to the study?
That's a good question. There is some substance to the question. And I hope that the FMCSA's research will help us get through this. I'm sure that the hours of service regulations are too restrictive.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the problem, not the actual ELDs.
Yeah.
Because there are companies out there who've been using ELDs for the last 5 years, and they've been fine.
Casandra, who names these things? Who names the FMCSA Large Truck Crash Casual Factor Study? It sounds like the worst chain restaurant in America.
It so does. And it sounds intense.
It's fast casual.
It's kind of crazy when I hear it.
It's like Chipotle.
It's like the kind of party you're supposed to go to. It's apparently business casual. It's fast casual.
Well, their last study. So is this a huge waste of taxpayer money? It says it was. They said they did that study for 2 years and they came out saying it was related to driver related action or inaction. I mean, couldn't that be anything then? Isn't that literally everything?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, that might have been a little bit of a waste.
Right.
I'm hoping that their future research will really help us and dive into, are the regulations actually working for these drivers? Do we need something different? Or are the regulations right on? And everybody just needs to stop complaining.
Yeah.
You know, from the beginning, you know, talking with Dean Croak, even before like ELDs were implemented, he immediately, immediately was like, this HOS thing is not going to work. It's too restrictive. And ever since then, I haven't heard much validity to how they are effective. Why is it so hard to make some reasonable changes here?
I don't know. That's such
why. The FMCSA, the government's involved. That's why.
But I thought we had this new FMCSA guy, Ray Martinez. You know, I know he's gone.
He's gone.
Yeah.
He left.
But he was like doing all this big changes for things.
Well, maybe he was like, look, we need more flexibility in HOS. And they were like, be quiet, Ray. And he was like, you know what? I'm out. Right, Casandra?
We're purely speculating, but.
Yeah, for sure.
Is there any chance?
But, you know, I do like the regulations.
I was going to say, is there any chance that something happens?
Drivers on the road that are tired.
Yeah. I know, but shouldn't that be up to the driver when they're tired, as long as they only drive for 12 hours or 14 hours or whatever they say? Shouldn't they be able to divide that up however they see fit?
Do you want that up to the driver, Dooner?
Well, I don't know. Sometimes right it's now, up to it's dispatchers. Not up to them at all.
Yeah, sometimes, like, what if you sleep you have a good night's sleep, as I've heard some guys say, and then they're told, hold on for 10 more hours and then go, and they can't sleep 10 more hours. And then when they have to go, they're kind of getting tired.
Yeah, or it could be congested. Road conditions may not be ideal. They may not be able to find parking. What if 6 hours in I can find parking? And like, I'm going to sleep for 5 hours now, and then I'll get back on the road after rush hour.
Yeah, aren't there ways to keep up with it?
Mm-hmm.
What are they?
And there are, first of all, larger carriers. Or carriers who are used to the hours of service and being compliant with them. They do a lot of pre-trip planning and they understand how long these certain customers are going to have appointments, where their truck stops need to be. They've figured out how to make it work. So right now we're hearing from a lot of the small drivers who for the first time in their career actually have to be compliant with the hours of service.
Mm. Yeah. Casandra, so powerful things. We talked about this a lot on Road Dog Trucking last weekend, and all of the drivers, when we were talking about this fast casual dining establishment, I mean study, they said they all wanted flexibility. They're like, you know what? We're fine. We know the ELDs are here to stay. We just think it's not the device. It's the regulation that causes the device to work that way. But I feel like we're going to have this argument until the end of time. Cassandra, how do people reach out and learn more?
You know, when everybody just Google me, Casandra Gaines, transportation law.
All right, give us your final point. Give us your
you find me anywhere Dooner is.
Give us your closing point.
Okay, you ready? Yeah. Anyone who suddenly complains to you about ELD compliance, they haven't been complying with the law.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Have you, Chad?
So
that's the biggest thing complaining. That you need to remember.
Okay.
All right, Casandra. Good stuff. We love having you on video now. This is I'm sure next time will be even smoother.
Yeah.
Well, even better.
All right. Have a nice weekend.
Bigger and better.
We'll see you soon. Great. That was awesome stuff.
Fantastic. I feel like we're circling in on some key issues in the industry.
Some key issues in the industry. Like, yeah. The pricing power index.
Like predators.
The DHL supply chain pricing power index with our friend Kevin Hill, who is definitely not going to miss his appointment this time.
He wouldn't dare.
Price.
fired up now.
Hey, sir.
How you guys doing?
How are you? Oh, you're coming in hot. No, it's good.
We're great. We just visited with Casandra, and we had her on video. Now we've got you.
Yeah, in person. Right.
In person.
That would have been funny if she actually was in that. She was in a spray-painted alley. Did you see that?
I did see that.
She has better hair.
She does.
Well, it's kind of a low.
That's a low jab. I'm sorry. I love you, man.
You do a podcast called Great Quarter, guys, but starting Wednesday, this man and I will be tag teaming on a brand new podcast on the Freightcast Networks and FreightWaves TV called Put That Coffee Down. Now, I'll tell you something, too. I was looking up I wanted to watch Glenn Ross, easy for me to say, last night, and you know, it's like out of print. You can't buy it on iTunes. It's not streaming anywhere except for HBO.
Well, can you not buy it digital? I might have a digital copy of it, like on Amazon.
Can you find it? Can you just torrent it?
Oh, you, like,
it was on Netflix at some point.
Yeah, of course. It's not on Netflix anymore. It's only on HBO at the moment.
Okay. Well, I'm glad I have HBO because I need to go home and watch that movie this weekend and get prepared for some sales training, ABCs.
I watched The Boiler Room last night.
Oh, that's such a great movie.
Yeah.
So why do you put the coffee down? Why aren't you picking the coffee up?
Because coffee's for closers.
Yeah.
Coffee's for closers.
And unless you're a closer, put that coffee down.
Yeah. You've never seen the movie? It's a pretty famous.
Have you not seen it?
Chad.
No, I never have.
All right.
Yeah.
It was required watching to listen to our podcast.
Yes. Yes. And actually, that's the rule is going to be in our intro. It's going to be hang up. Who listens to a podcast on a phone?
I like the design. Yeah. I like the coffee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thing and that's really cool design.
Yeah. What's going on with the bad news in the DHL supply chain pricing power index?
You know, it's January, so we're sliding down. We're down to 30. We're at 35 last week. We've been coming down off 45 since the peak holiday season.
Yeah.
And, you know, as you get closer to zero, then shippers have the more power they have. Closer to zero, so we had just some flat volumes, rejections, capacity is loosening up in the market. And all the public companies, just about to a T, that have come out with their Q4 earnings, which were bad to begin with, but they have said that January is not great.
One of the
really not great.
One of the basics of Sonar was just the thought that if you can look at stock, you can look at spot rates almost like stocks, right? And you can kind of tell earnings based on that a company is going to have. And then when you see something like if you had a stock and it fell from $1.62 to $1.41, you open up Robinhood, you go, well, that sucks, right? Because the arrow's going down and there's a negative number next to it, and it's red, right?
Yes.
If it goes up, it's green. Well, right now, the spot rates went from $1.62 to $1.41, according to the past trends in DAT, not the freight forecasting or
that
the freight outlook.
That is true. So you have the historical spot pricing. It's coming down to $1.40, which is about the operating cost per mile for a truck. So it really can't go too much lower for a sustained period, but we're thinking, January is always a bad month, early February until it starts getting warmer in most regions of the country. So it's just kind of a battling out. You still have a lot of capacity out there, and something that we'll be talking about more in about an hour.
Yeah, guys. So, Tate, this will be one of the gentlemen on there, and I think you're kicking it off with me, right?
I am, yeah.
So right after the show at 2 o'clock, we're going to be doing 2020 Freight Outlook presented by Emerge. You'll be in here. Craig Fuller is going to be coming in. JT will be in here. JP will be in here.
Anthony will be in here.
Yeah.
Mike B will be in here.
There'll be a lot of people in here. And we'll have a phone line open. So you'll be in here too. And you can also get in here via LinkedIn because we're monitoring you right now. Or I think Chad's looking at the Facebook. So have at it.
Yeah.
All right.
The Facebook.
What was the biggest indicator though? So why did it fall? If you had to pick any of the metrics, what was the big one?
I think the lack of really any good news for the week, though, was probably the biggest metric is that the absence of anything good. Refrigerated is actually about 14% above load volume wise above where it was in January 2019. So that's good news.
That's about it.
So everything else flat, falling, and basically a lot of bleak outlooks for the first quarter from the public companies that have reported so far.
It's almost as low as the pricing power index has ever been since its inception, right? I recall a 25.
Yeah, that was
pretty bad. We got down to 15.
Oh, we
right,
did.
Right, yeah. Before, like in late October, early November, before peak season.
Okay.
So I hope we don't retest those lows coming between here and spring.
Right. I mean, yeah. The three-month outlook, almost every time we visit, mm-hmm. Seemed to be remaining at 50. Now that it's trended down to 30, are we still? Because
we're at 45 now.
Oh,
at 45 and a three-month outlook.
Okay.
You know, I think the second half will be a little bit better, but I'll explain that and why I think that much more in about an hour at 2 o'clock.
Yeah.
About 2:15, we'll talk about trucking capacity.
So before you go, and do you think that the coronavirus will have any impact on interstate trucking at all in the U.S., domestic trucking, or something really, really bad have to happen?
You know, something really, really bad would have to happen. There'd have to be a real disruption of freight flows from China.
Yeah.
But if that does happen and port traffic, especially on the West Coast, goes down, it could have some major effects for this year.
Thanks, Kevin.
Okay.
Appreciate it.
Thanks so much, Kevin.
And download his podcast. Great quarter, guys. It's excellent.
It's a good tease.
Yeah. Now we're going to look at a little bit of freight forecast. We're talking about freight outlook, and the best way to have an outlook is through a forecast, not through past trends, Chad.
Right.
It's through the forecast, and that's why we do things like this with Michael Vincent. Stepping back in the studio. You've been a regular now on the truck.
Regular.
Coming in. And this time we're doing a little
foretelling or forthtelling.
Freight forecasting
with Michael Vincent.
Wow. Is that you on guitar, Vincent?
Yeah, it is. How'd you get that tape?
Wow. Man, nice.
That must have been from the early years.
You were ripping.
That was from the early years. I've improved greatly since then. Wow, look at this.
That's a mini cowbell. One day our logo will be on there. Or so we've been promised. It's been a while.
And we'll have 500
taking
of these.
Some time.
You got a Sharpie? Yeah. I can take that.
One day.
Yeah, one day we can just write them on each one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, dig that shirt. Look at you.
Oh, yeah. American Line Haul. Thanks for sponsoring the party at Air Cargo 2020. We got a cowboy hat. We got a bandana. We got to be at the Country Music Hall of Fame.
Yeah, we missed the entire thing.
You don't need to tell everybody about that. Uh-huh. We forgot to take a ride in Albuquerque and missed.
That's because they had a sign that said no food or drink, and we weren't about to set down our beer.
Revealing all of our
secrets. Pretty true.
Yeah,
it was pretty accurate.
Before we jump in, let's recap it really quick. How did how was Air Cargo 2020 for you and the team, your experience in Nashville? Good time?
It was great. It was better than I expected, to tell you. It was my first time going, right? And I didn't know what to expect. But it was awesome. A lot of great context, a lot of good information, a lot of good conversations. It was awesome.
Nice seeing new faces too, right?
Absolutely.
Some companies we don't typically get to talk to and evangelize the power of sonar, the power of FreightWaves Media, all that good stuff.
Diverse array of people in logistics and the supply chain.
It really is, right? I was just thinking I'd need to get my interstellar CDL, right, for NASA.
Yeah. He's going to be back on radio.
Oh, wow.
Radio this weekend.
Yeah, that's really
interesting.
Also,
guy.
We met integrators. We met freight forwarders.
Yeah. Yes, we did. Insurance people were there as well. There was a lot of insurance there, right?
Yeah.
So Roanoke was there, a couple others.
Yeah.
Right? Yep.
So tell me about it. What is on your show, you cover a lot. Well, that's the show that's coming up.
Show.
That's not your show. I know it was hanging up last time. I don't know. I keep pointing to like the WrestleMania banner after you win the Royal Rumble.
Yeah.
So you do a show called Freight Forecaster.
That's correct.
You are the Freight Forecaster on Freight Forecasting.
Yes.
Which is out on Thursdays.
It is.
At 3 o'clock?
I think it's 3 o'clock.
3 o'clock.
I think that's right.
So you just
3 o'clock.
You just work
just
it for
tell
an
me
hour.
Where to go.
The number one thing that people confuse is a trend with a forecast. What's the difference?
So a trend, you're watching a trend, you can see what is happening, right? And there are definite trends, but forecasting is actually predicting what is going to happen, right?
Yeah.
So I can look at trends, right? I mean, like you look at what is the major leagues. Congratulations, boy, you've won one in a row. Make it another and that's a trend.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, well, isn't it also putting together a number of factors and sort of analyzing?
A lot of factors, right? So you're looking at different data sets and bringing those together and looking for correlations. right? And looking for true correlations, right? Not just spurious, right?
As right.
Nike like the shoe sales correlate to the outbound tender rejections in Miami.
Wow.
Sometimes right. it does and over a course, but it really isn't a correlation.
Or like
right?
the Houston Astros won the World Series by
therefore,
cheating.
Therefore, they were cheating.
Is this a trend or a...
yeah,
or
exactly.
a forecast that they'll win again.
Well, yeah, it was exactly. a trend, right? Because the Red Sox did it the year before.
Cheating, yeah. I suppose, is a trend, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's more of a cause and effect type thing.
But as Bobby Heenan once said, if you ain't cheating, you ain't trying.
Ooh.
Pete Rose said that, too.
That's right. That's right.
So how do you forecast accurately, though? So it's one thing for us to just BS and be like, you know what I forecast based on the trends of the performance by the Chiefs? They're going to win the Super Bowl. There's a hippopotamus that predicted the Chiefs are going to win a Super Bowl
that's
by
right.
vomiting.
And there's Punxsutawney Phil, too.
Yeah,
right?
yes. but the but it's only got a 50% accuracy rate, that hippopotamus.
So how do we get beyond 50% accuracy rates?
Very difficult. Lots of data, lots of analytics. It's a lot of art. It's a lot of science. As I was talking about yesterday on the show, is there is a lot of art to it, finding those different data sets that work together. So
is there too
you've got to have experts, right?
Can you, like, have too much information?
I don't believe
anywhere,
so.
Anywhere, yeah.
Oh.
I don't believe so.
Really?
Well, depends on the context,
I mean,
right?
At a certain point, yes. But, yeah. I mean, it's not to say that simpler is better. It's not. More is better to a certain point, right? I mean, you don't want to get into, analysis to paralysis, certainly.
Yeah.
But you also don't want to look at two different data sets and say, oh, here's the forecast.
Well, how do you bring up a good work. Thing. How do you parse the information right. if there is, because as Chad is saying, a lot of information, it might just be overwhelming, as you mentioned, option paralysis.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So,
paradox of choice.
Yeah, so a lot of it is whoever the freight forecaster is, right? You can't be an expert in all things.
Yes.
And so when you're forecasting, especially in freight, there's so many different factors. You've got to have experts like we do here at FreightWaves that cross different verticals, different modes.
Do you,
right? So you got to have someone who's an economist like Anthony,
right?
Who understands what's going on. You've got to have a rail expert. You got to have an air cargo expert, a maritime expert, these type of things, and maybe some of them overflow. They're experts in more than one
right.
field, but certainly Anthony is not a maritime expert. He is an economics.
So we look at the different
expert,
the,
right?
the different
tell him
modes.
You said that.
Huh?
I'm going to tell him you said that. No, I'm just kidding.
So we
he will know. He,
please
he
don't make
it.
Him mad at me.
Okay. He's a big
we look at the different modes. Do we also look at like early indicators? What's happening right now? Lagging indicators.
Yes, absolutely. There's lagging and in early indicators, etc. So and there's backcasting, right? You've got to backcast to prove out your models.
Huh.
Right, so you look
so
at
that's
where
the lagging might come in.
Well, lagging is certainly something that shows that proves that this is actually what occurred or what your forecast was. So you've got to look back at the data and say, okay, I forecasted this. Did I do it on accident or not?
Yeah.
Right. So you've got to do some backcasting to figure out whether you do, and lagging indicators help you with that information as well. Right. So you forecasted certain things, and then you see the lagging indicators that would indicate that, yes, that forecast actually I didn't forecast it on accident. It wasn't a lucky guess. Right.
Mm. So I was going to say, because we have to wrap it up, but yeah. You have a lot of information on your show, Freight Forecasting. How do people find it and check in? Because you have two episodes now.
I have two episodes out there, right? Right. So on FreightWaves TV, right? And on YouTube, our YouTube.
Good gal. Yeah, right? Download the app.
It's out there, right? So, we've got some good viewership. It's up this week. So that's kind of cool, which I didn't really expect. But, hey, actually.
Build it and they
maybe
will
there's
come.
Something here, right?
Yeah.
So the first
yeah.
two were very, very high level. So the next one coming out next week, we're going to get deep into it. I think Anthony is probably going to be on next week. We'll get into some economic indicators and look at how you can use those for forecasting and start to dig into the more of the specifics instead of just the broader what it is and who is a freight forecaster, et cetera. So,
nice.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thanks for joining us.
Vincent.
Thanks. We
love
appreciate
you guys.
Dude, the animal.
Love you too, man. Take
peace
it easy.
Peace and love. Remain
all
groovy.
Right.
All right. Now it's time to look
thanks,
at earnings, man. That's something that people wish they could. Well, they are forecasted, right? You know, the forecasted estimated earnings per share. That's a forecast. But as we know from these, the forecasts aren't always right, or else they would always be on the number, wouldn't
but
they?
I guess they give us guidance, though.
They rarely split. Where is Donnie?
I just
Donnie's
saw him.
Supposed to come in next.
Donnie, come on, man.
Yeah, like
where's
clockwork.
Our showrunner?
Get him in here. No delays.
Hey,
no delays, showrunner.
How you doing?
Hello, man?
Hello,
sirs.
Did you get hung up in a conversation out there?
No, I didn't know.
Oh, okay. Nice. Okay. You guys are going to play a game called Earnings Over Under where we go through the earnings, right?
I got it.
Oh, I just got a little adrenaline rush.
I got it.
All right. Wow. Who won last time you guys played?
It was a good. It was a good fight.
It was like a 1 point.
It was down to 1 point. Okay, yep. But I think you won.
Yep.
All right, so that means Chad will have to go first because he's the loser.
But I won last week.
Okay, you will go first.
No, wait, no, I was down. I was down and I came back.
Amazon, be quiet. Amazon earnings. I'm not arguing over this anymore. Amazon earnings per share, $3.98.
Up.
All right, he's going over.
Over.
They're way over. It was $6.47. You guys are smart. You read the news. You read FreightWaves.com. Amazon share price, and their shares are crazy. Like, I am so glad
that. Oh, man, did they kill it.
I'm glad that Amazon, that Robinhood and a lot of apps now are adding fractional shares because I can't afford a share of Amazon, right? Or a share of Google. I'd like to get in on that action because you know that they're going to keep going up. But
I know.
Well, after hours trading, they were up as much as $2.35 a share. They've breached the $2,000 a share mark during those 45 minutes of trading. As of 6 p.m. last night, they were up over $2.02. I think they're still up today. They rang up $12.9 billion shipping tab. It was 43% higher than last year, but it's really starting to pay off. What a gamble that they made, but a gamble on themselves. And Amazon typically wins these things.
Yeah.
Unless it's
those
the Fire
Amazonians.
Phone, right? Unless it's the Fire Phone. Or have you seen the glasses they put out, the Amazon glasses? Are you going to replace yours?
I thought those were the Google glasses.
Alexa glass now.
Oh.
All they do is you can talk to them.
They make it too easy to win stuff.
Oh, I know.
Yeah.
They've hurt my bank account bad this year.
Amazon does?
Yes.
I know, and it's so impulsive. Like, if you were in a store, you have to walk all the way to the register. You might put it down.
Swipe.
And you might have to use real money or
just wait till those drones start bringing it to you in 30 minutes.
Just wait until NASA does it in 5 minutes. All right, Tesla. Tesla, Chad. Earnings per share, $1.72.
Over.
All right.
I'll go with under.
Oh, you shouldn't have done that.
Donnie.
Yeah, they were over. Tesla did very well.
Tesla's surprising people.
They were over 214. Its epic rise has fueled murmurings of a bubble, but the company's latest earnings release continues this upbeat accounting. Tesla delivered a record number of vehicles, 112,000 plus in Q4 and 367,000 vehicles for all of 2019. That's up 50% from the year before.
Wow.
So they're really getting this manufacturing thing down. And as they do that, their costs will go down. And Cybertruck's coming out in 2021.
And you might pay the actual price that you expected. Did you get the level 1, 2, or 3 one?
You have to get the mid.
You got the mid?
Yeah.
I see them all over the place. So that must mean they're
Cybertrucks?
Doing well. No, the Teslas. I see them all over the place now.
Yeah.
It used to be like a rare sighting. And now I'm like every day. They're passing me, burning up the highway. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
They're signing up more for Class 8 trucks as well.
I know. They're finally delivering those, right?
0 to 60.
What's the new predicted date on that?
They're supposed to deliver a few this year, I think. That was the most recent article I read.
Oh.
I haven't seen any latest news on that.
In a truck.
Empty, though. 20 seconds, 0 to 60, 80,000 pounds.
That's still crazy.
That's crazy.
Yeah,
that's
but it's those batteries that are suspect.
Now, Donnie, if that were to hit a battleship, what would happen?
Go right on through.
Just go right through the battleship. All right, USA Truck, Chad, earnings. No, Donnie, USA Truck, earnings per share, 8 cents.
Boom, down.
Under.
Down, low, under.
It was way under. It was negative 52 cents. They lost 52 cents. Tough quarter for USA Truck. It's prompted the company to announce more organizational changes, including an 8% reduction in non-driver staff. So a lot of people in the office not going to have a desk to walk back to. They're going to get that cardboard box.
They're going to make some changes, that's for sure.
You ever get a hand to the cardboard box?
Not yet.
I have. It's not fun.
The company you have.
Do what?
Never. You never have. Have you done sales at a 3PL?
Before?
I was purchasing for, pricing. I was carrier reps and all that. But I've never been handed the box.
All right. When you do sales, you can get handed the box pretty easily. Because that's just tough, especially in 3PL sales. They just burn through people. Like, you know, going in, you're not going to be loved. And, it's all numbers.
There are a few days I brought my own box, I thought.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
It didn't happen. I was confused.
When you get that email.
You're a survivor.
Like at 10:30 at night, it's never good to get that email from your boss that says bring in your cell phone or your laptop. That means,
Can we meet in the morning?
Yeah.
talk about forecasting.
Boeing earnings per share, $1.73, Chad.
Oh, down, under.
All right.
Yeah, Boeing's in trouble.
It was a bloodbath of a quarter. They lost $2.33 per share. The Boeing company, which is really bad considering that there's already some guidance put out. Everyone knows about the 737 MAX, but they still lost $2.33 per share. So I'm not sure how the market's reacting to that today, but I can imagine it must not be fun being a Boeing shareholder. They reported they lost $1 billion. They lost literally $1 billion and $1.10 billion.
What's a billion
on Wednesday,
among friends?
Largely because it's 737 MAX. Man, how damaging can that be to a company?
But it's also their new plane, the 777.
Yeah.
They just got off the ground.
Yeah.
One of its first test flights. How bad is it going to hurt the sales on that?
With that crash,
too? Good point.
Yeah. So, I mean, here, I haven't finished making this product. It's a bad product. I've got a new one coming out. Anybody want to buy it?
Didn't they have a missile that failed? I mean, it's just a lot of bad news.
Well, they can make those kind of bets. The problem with them is they can't really make bets with the airlines because that's their bread and butter. And it's hurting the other airlines. So, I mean, good news for Airbus, I guess.
It has an outsized effect on supply chains.
I guess the problem is you can only build so many planes a year. I mean, so Airbus can't catch up for Boeing's missed deliveries.
Yeah.
So, sure, Airbus is already backed up a few years on theirs. Yes, they'll be loving it. But it's not like cars. You can't roll 5 off a day, 30 off a day.
Yeah. Well, and we remember that article, Chad, that we covered where they were talking about the problem with the 737 MAX also is because they can't sell them and they've been grounded since last March. They're filling up warehouse space so they can't put other planes in there. Mm-hmm. And they're also getting that damn demurrage, man. Warehouse space is expensive.
Yeah.
Phew.
All right, guys.
I would call that a few headwinds.
Well, this is I think you only can have an opportunity to tie here. But this is a bonus one. We'll do it for I don't know, the WWE stock, Chad. WWE stock, did it drop over or under 22% yesterday?
I guess I'll go over.
All right.
Yeah, I'm going under.
Okay, playing for the win.
I'm going under.
You had to do that, right?
Nice try, Donnie.
No, shares.
Well, you win some, you lose some.
Shares of WWE stock, they plunged as much as 24% to $47.50. They're up almost near 100 at one point. They really peaked. But they kicked out a couple of key people there. Their CEO and their CRO said, see you later. They're worried about some contracts. They got a boon that they went up to 100 because of their live TV deals. They got one with USA, I think, and Fox, and like live sports is one of the, and wrestling's not really a sport, but sports entertainment, live content is one of the few things that does well.
Don't tell them it's not a sport.
Don't tell them it's not a sport. Didn't they start another league though this year?
NXT?
Something like that, but about 4 or 5 months ago.
Oh, AEW, yeah.
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 I think it's
you're really a wrestling fan. Huh? Do you watch the Royal Rumble?
No, I do not.
Oh,
but back in the day.
Is cheerleading a sport?
Yeah. I watched the Royal Rumble in our hotel room. It was a good one.
Oh, good.
Yeah, Shane McMahon booked it. That's why.
I'm not going to answer that.
You guys don't know.
I'm in trouble.
Yeah.
Cheerleading,
is it a sport? Yeah, anything physical is kind of a sport.
All right, then there you go.
This is a sport of competitive banter.
Yeah.
All right, well, Donnie, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Donnie. You know what? That's your participation trophy. Thank you.
Yeah, baby doll.
Gave you a big hand right there.
Well, that was good. Now we got to move on to our next segment. One of my favorite.
Bad news and good news.
Boom.
What do you want first?
All right. Good news.
Okay.
Whoa.
That's what I want.
That's actually my son, too, who said that right there. He likes to say that. He says that all the time, but sometimes he won't even have good news or bad news. He'll just say, I have some bad news and some good news. He'll be like, well, what is it? And then he'll just be like, I pooped my pants. I'm like, there is no good news there because then I have to, change it, too.
That's kind of a mixed result, I guess.
Good news. The majority of transportation and logistics executives expect their business, so this is about confidence, expect their business to grow by more than 10% in 2020.
Oh.
And they say they are very likely to consider a merger, an acquisition, an investment, some kind of transaction. They're not really sure. They're like one of those. They're like, I'm just feeling spendthrift.
Yeah, very good news.
That's according to a survey gathered by BGSA's annual conference. But here's the bad news.
Oh.
Here's the bad news. It's coming on the heels of 2019 where growth was under 5%.
Yeah.
But he said he's particularly bullish on what he called e-commerce ripple effects, including micro-warehousing facilities, fulfillment, last mile, reverse logistics, and maturation of technology. So he thinks the smart companies are going to get involved in those things. So if you're listening to him, there might be some. Those might be the good places to acquire.
Yeah, I think it's maturing, don't you? I think we're still in the early innings, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I've got some good news.
What is it?
Well, it's reefer demand. You know, Kevin Hill was telling us everything's looking bleak. He did mention reefer. But reefer demand, it's very seasonal, and it makes up about 12 to 20% of contracted freight. Well, it's up year over year, by 13%.
Mm.
Well, I think that's something worth celebrating, don't you?
Yeah.
All right. Well, there's bad news, of course, because that's the segment we're playing. The bad news is their drive van counterparts are down 1% year over year. Yeah, the same supply side constrictions that inhibit dry van growth are exaggerated for reefer carriers, because reefer trailers are 3 to 5 times. I don't know if you knew this, because you do know what you've been in supply chain a while, but you know they're 3 to 5 times more expensive than dry van trailers. And so it's harder, obviously, to enter the space because it takes a big investment.
All right.
Yeah. So, they're doing well.
Are we going to get through this one?
I thought you wanted some analysis, but
no,
you know
I got
what?
Enough.
We won't do it to all paralysis.
Right. The most recent reading from the Logistics Managers Index, the LMI, show the industry has expanded, but the bad news is it's at the slowest rate in the history of the LMI. So the December results are the lowest inventory level in the history of the LMI, and the first time falling below 50, signaling that there was a substantial buildup prior to the holiday season. So one of the things that made it look good were because of that peak. The index from December is down 20.8 points from the level it was a year ago. But here, respondents predict that the overall level next year, the LMI will be up 63.3%. So overall, that's why they're going to make those mergers and acquisitions, because this is another sentiment index, right? And they're feeling pretty good, those logistics managers.
Well,
that sounds like an exciting event, too.
Yeah, and that sounds like maybe more good news than bad with all of that optimism.
Well, the bad news is just that it's not there yet, so we're forecasting, which is good, but we're not there.
And we have learned about what that is today. Good news! The U.S. is creating the most badass carrier ever. The USS Gerald R. Ford is a top priority right now and is going to have state-of-the-art defense systems. The cost is $13 billion, but it's just getting underway with 18 months of verification tests at sea. Are you excited?
Yeah.
But the bad news is 3 of the defense systems have been found deficient in recent tests, raising questions about whether the aircraft carrier will actually be able to defend itself, according to the Pentagon's testing office. And here's where the deficiencies and limitations lie. They were found in the radar, the electronic surveillance, and the ship-to-ship communications data network.
Oh, is that it?
Yeah, that's all. I mean,
sounds pretty important stuff.
What's
we can't build ships or planes anymore? What is going on with quality control?
What's electronic surveillance amongst friends when you're all on the ship together?
Well, here's a comforting story.
Okay.
This is when we're going to start to go to the birds here. Bad news. Rescuers found an
Starting
owl.
With the bad, okay.
Bad news. Oh, always start with bad. It's bad news, good news. Not good news, bad news. Bad news. Rescuers found an owl that they thought to be injured in a ditch. So that's not good. You don't want to find an owl in a ditch. But the good news is, it turns out that the owl wasn't hurt. It was just too fat to fly. According to Sky News, it was just obese, and it was naturally obese, so like it wasn't eating out of trash cans or anything. It was just catching a lot of mice, so a really good hunter.
Oh.
But I guess the downfall of being a really good hunter, like you think of a hunter being very physical.
Yeah.
But I guess when you're just like up in that tree and you move that head around 360 degrees, you can just find
things easily. So is it going to, does it have a new weight loss program?
Well, the good news is that, the sanctuary said it was just simply extremely obese, but they put it on a diet,
good.
And it lost the weight, had to lose a third of its weight, and it did it. And now it's back free in the wild, but will it stick to the weight loss program? Who knows?
I get it. I get it. Don't know, man. Let's hope it does. Maybe some intermittent fasting. And we now have more bad news. We are seeing it streaming on our live broadcast. Bad news: a bald eagle, the avian symbol of America, struck the windshield of a fully loaded tractor trailer on Interstate 95 in Connecticut.
Wow.
Yeah, the impact, it pushed in the windshield and shattered the safety glass. Despite the shock and a face full of glass dust, Burke, a driver with 25 years of experience, he managed to pull over and stop his rig within about 3,000 feet. Mm. So he gets out, and this is the good news. The bald eagle had jumped from the windshield and fled underneath the tractor trailer. He had assumed to find it dead, but instead it was just badly hurt, very much alive. Since then, the eagle has gone into a place called Hope, an organization that specializes in caring for birds of prey. And the female eagle has been on the mend, and the organization expects to release it back into the wild soon.
All right, better looking bird, the eagle or the owl?
I'm going to say the eagle.
I mean, this particular eagle or that particular owl?
Yeah, I think she's beautiful. Look, she's beautiful bald.
Okay. Yeah. No,
bald is beautiful.
Yes, like Kevin Hill.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Now it is time that we hear from you, the listener.
Giddy up.
Comment Section Rodeo.
All right, from the article, ex-Celadon CEO Paul Finlan lands new job at STG Logistics. Marlo Dawn Williams, she says, snort, or should I just snort? Well, good for him. So nice he has a cush-cush job, while the drivers who actually busted their hump were left out in the cold.
Art says, upper management at most companies is a joke. Good old boys, girls club continues. Management comes and goes, often within 1 year's time. What can you do productive within 1 year as an outside hire? Learn while getting paid. What a great return on investment.
Wow. Okay. So Bill Hood, he's got a counterpoint, though. He said, I don't know why the owl came back on screen. He said, I am guessing that most of he's that is not Paul Finlan. Paul Finlan is not an owl. I assure you that is the obese owl that came back on the screen. Bill Hood wrote, I am guessing that most of these comments are from people that have no idea of the history of Celadon. Paul is the person that took over what was an impossible situation after the former executives committed fraud and have been charged. He was kind of like the wolf in Pulp Fiction. You know, you come in after the blood is already on the seats and you're supposed to clean up and see if you can bring it back together. Yeah,
yeah, boy, he did a good job in Pulp Fiction. He was no nonsense.
Oh, here's another one. From the article, Baton Trucking takes aim at driver retention. Self-driving trucks will never work. Maintenance will be too high to compete with the current system. They can't even build a truck that doesn't need new wiring harnesses for the lights twice a year. Where the self-driving truck's electronics it will fail results in fatalities that will bankrupt the company. I wouldn't bet $1,000 on self-driving trucks, let alone millions. You will need specialized sensors to monitor everything, and anybody who ever drove a truck knows how many times the faulty ABS light comes on and off and on and fixed and back on the pump. Good luck with that. Salt and weather don't play well with wiring and electronics. A truck driver in a day with your self-driving cars due in a month. You don't have a clue what you're getting into.
Who was that, Mr. Potato Head from Toy Story?
I was starting out going for Sven, but I lost the plot. Sven from...
Oh, okay. No, that was pretty good. All right, well...
You know, can I have a car? Well, actually, I guess it's Kristoff, as we learned a week ago.
Oh.
Yeah, Sven can't really talk. It's just... So I guess that was a Kristoff doing Sven impression.
This is Noble One. He's got a new long... Should we say his whole name? Is it, he's Shamash, Utu, the Babylonian god of sun, god of justice, morality, and truth.
He's really... He's really just taken over.
Well, so here is what he says. Self-driving trucks will never work. You mean like the World Wide Web was first viewed to be impossible? Then cell phones. Cell phones without buttons, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Like they told Trevor Milton at NMC that he wouldn't succeed. How about aircraft? That too was viewed to be nuts and impossible. Imagine tons and weight flying. Well, it's happening.
What about bumblebees?
They are completely redesigning the trucks like they should have done decades upon decades ago. Look at your television. Does it resemble anything like in the 1980s? They improved it, didn't they? It works, doesn't it? The trucking industry has been asleep, but now waking up. It's about time they did. Now, if only truck drivers could awaken and unite to improve their circumstances collectively. Now, that would be something. Don't tell me that's impossible. Organized labor unions succeed in having laborers unite. Truck drivers can too, but on a much larger scale, and eliminate all the middlemen who pick up the pockets in the process, in my humble opinion.
I think that's almost becoming ironic. He's not as humble as he used to be.
Not he's now that he's even the Babylonian sun god of justice.
He has anointed himself with many pen names now. I think he might have some sock accounts on our own board too. And he argues with himself. Yes. All right.
Well, we're giving him a voice.
What about the Impossible
section,
Burger? Bob Hornsberger, speaking of Impossible Burgers, Bob Hornsberger says, there is nothing wrong with the logging devices. The problem is so many drivers are spending too much time in truck stops and washing their trucks in rest areas, just hanging out. just milling about there. I haven't suffered any loss in wages. So really, if they get off their fat, lazy asses, they would make good money. They company I drive for, we have drivers making like $100,000 a year.
Man,
come and join us.
That was really realistic. How did you do so good with that accent? Mark E. Dickey says, okay, so you have to run by the law. So when you ran a logbook, you could change your status. Now that it's e-log, you have to run by at law. Sorry for your loss. This is what happens when people was running against the law. Again, sorry for your loss. Find a company that pays good money. Otherwise, just keep crying.
Dude, I wasn't crying. I was just telling you how it is at the carrier I work for. At the carrier I work for, I make over $100,000 a year.
Sorry for your loss.
No, I make so much money. I spend the summer in Cape Cod, dude.
All I hear is a lot of crying.
Sorry for your loss.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that's what happens.
It is.
Hey, so coming up,
the wheels on the truck go round and round.
We mentioned a few times coming up after the show, there is going to be 2020 Freight Outlook presented by Emerge. A lot of key players here, smart individuals here are going to be talking about what their different verticals and divisions here have been studying, their outlook for the year, their forecasts and all that stuff. I'll be moderating. I think we'll have phone lines open. It'll be curious to see how that turns out. That'll be great.
Yeah, good time.
Hey, a lot of content came out on FreightCast this week and FreightWaves TV. Much of it was beginning of the week. We started out in Nashville.
Keeping the cadence going. That's right. Oh, man. We started out with a blitz, didn't we?
Yeah. We did three What the Trucks when we were in Nashville.
Oh, wow.
So there's three of those up online. They came out Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. We released all those. I think all the videos are
twice
done
as
out
much.
There now.
One is good. Two is better.
And those ones are interesting. They're a little bit more evergreen because we're just interviewing people. We don't really get into the news on those. That's more for the show we do in the studio.
Right on.
Yeah. Do you have a format you like better? Do you like doing this kind, or do you like being out there? Do you like how once in a while we get to mix it up?
I will say that the getting out there gives me a little anxiety at first, but once you get out there, you really start feeling the energy, and I really enjoy it. I guess I would say both, and if I can have that as an option.
But it always seems like it would be boringer than it is because you're like, it's a logistics conference. Like, how fun could it be? But there's a lot of smart people who operate in this and a lot of, like, really funny, just whip-smart dudes and dudettes who just really kind of get the game.
And they want to be on.
Yeah, they do want to be on. We're surprising. And you know, people are starting to recognize the show, too. So, like, it's not that hard to get guests. And when you guys see us out there on the battlefield, make sure to reach out. And actually, I would recommend now, if you know we're going to be at something, reach out in advance on LinkedIn or to Emily's Vince or something like that.
Give us a little more time to prep.
Because now, like, a year ago, we would show up and we would kind of just go up to people and be like, do you want to come
That's
on?
That's right. I remember that.
And now we're booked in advance before we can even get there, which is... which is cool, too. I mean, I don't know. It's funny. Like, when you're in a growing company, things grow very fast.
One of the advantages of being a part of a fast-growth startup, skyrocketing into the orbit along with NASA.
Yes, FreightWaves Insiders with Mark Weiss. That is out on podcast players everywhere. Or subscribe to FreightCast. Get every FreightWaves podcast. In addition to that, he is going to be on radio this weekend, SiriusXM's Road Dog Trucking.
He's a great interview.
Along with Shelley Simpson from JB Hunt.
Oh, wow.
You may have heard of her.
Heavy hitters.
Yes, heavy hitters on the show. That is 3 to 5 p.m. SiriusXM's Road Dog Trucking, channel 146. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, thank you.
On this little show that we call
What the Trucks.
So bang your little cowbell into the weekend.
Here, let me ring my little cowbell.
Bang your little cowbell for February. Hey, shortest week of the year, baby. Bang your little cowbell
for intermittent fasting.
Cool. Bang your little cowbell for a positive freight outlook, right? I hope we have one. Stay tuned. It's going to be up here in just under 10 minutes. And a little cowbell for you. Yeah, you.